This is lesson 2.2. In this lesson, we're going to be solving equations where there's variables on both sides of the equal sign. We'll also be looking at application problems. So we'll be looking at problems where when we set up the equation, variables will be on both sides. This continues our sort of study or looking at how equations can be used to model real life and mathematical situations. The main algebra part of this is how do I deal with variables on both sides in order to solve an equation? So today we'll be looking at equations where variables are on both sides. So that means we are still trying to isolate the variable though. And so we'll need to get those variables to be on the same side and together, combine them together. And so we have to figure out how we're going to do that and what that looks like. As we're working through some of these equations, we may end up having fractions. We'll look at some problems where there'll be distributive property. And we may even need to combine like terms as part of our equation solving process. And we'll be using inverse operations in order to isolate the different pieces of information. So the biggest thing to understand is when you look at this problem, I need to get the n's to be together. And right now I have a 5n on the left side and a 3n on the right side. And in this situation then, well, how do I deal with that? How do I get them to be together? I can't just add them together because they're on opposite sides of the equal sign. And that is a common mistake that students make. So in order to get them together, if you look down at the bottom here, they're on opposite sides of the fence. They're on opposite sides of that equal sign. And so in order to get them together, I have to use opposite operations. So the same way that I would eliminate this 6 by subtracting 6 from both sides to make that 6 disappear on the right, I'm going to do the same thing with the 3n. I can add or subtract it. So it's connected to the 6 by addition, and this is a plus 3n. So the opposite of a plus 3n is a minus 3n. And if I do it on one side, then I have to do it on the other side. So what that does is notice that on the right side, my n's have now disappeared. They've gone to 0, and I'm left with just 6 on the right side. On the left side, these are like terms, and you should line them up so that you can see that they're like terms and see what you're supposed to add or subtract together. And I'm going to do that math. So I have 5n minus 3n, which gives me 2n, and then bring down the minus 2 because we haven't done anything with that yet. And then after that, in this situation, we just had a two-step equation. Now I want to stress here that we did not have to start that way. If you wanted to subtract 5n from both sides and solve, you could do that. If you wanted to add 2 to both sides, if you wanted to subtract 6 from both sides, there were actually 4 different things you could do to start this problem. So there isn't a right thing to do. There are multiple right things to do, and that's okay. It doesn't matter to me how you solve it as long as you're not breaking any of the math rules and you meet your expectations for the class as far as what work needs to be shown. So now we just have a basic two-stepper. So we'll get rid of adding and subtracting first, just like all our other equations that we've done in the past lessons. Negative 2 plus 2 gives me 0. On the other side, we now have 8. Divide both sides by 2 in order to get n equals 4. Notice in all of this, I tried to keep my equal sign lined up. Again, that's about organization, so that it's easy to keep track of what's on the left side and what's on the right side. Because the 3n and the 5n are not on the same side, we had to use opposite operations in order to get them together. So the thing to remember here is that if they're on opposite sides, then we use opposite operations to get rid of them and to move them around. Now, I'm going to pause for you for a second, and an answer is going to pop up for the second equation that I wrote down. I'm going to solve it differently just so you can see that you get the same answer. So in the second example, you can see that instead of subtracting the 3n, I subtracted the 5n. While my work looks a little bit different, I still ended up with the same answer at the end. So you may solve your problems on the homework a little bit differently than your neighbor or that I do if I do it on the board, but that's okay. As long as we end up with the same result, and as long as you're showing the correct algebra and not breaking any of the algebra rules, we don't have any problems. So let's look at another example. One thing that students tend to do is they try to keep the x coefficient to be positive. So if you wanted to, you could subtract 14 from both sides, do the opposite of plus 14. However, if you're trying to keep the x term to have a positive coefficient, then you would want to add the 57 to both sides. So I'm going to add 57 to both sides. The opposite of minus 57 is plus 57. So in 57x. And when we add those together, we end up with 71x minus 93 equals 49. You'll notice that for these first couple examples, and until we start doing more complex problems in the next lesson, that we end up with a two-step equation after doing that first step. So then we end up adding 93 to both sides. The opposite of minus 93 is add 93. 71x equals 142. Opposite of multiplication is division, so we'll divide both sides by 71, and we get x equals 2. Again, if you wanted to add 93 to both sides, or subtract 49 from both sides first, or if you really wanted to subtract 14x from both sides at the start, you are more than welcome to do that. So just to make things a little bit more interesting, let's actually move the negative 5h over to the right side. So the h's are on opposite sides, so I need to use opposite operations. The opposite of a negative 5h is a plus 5h. And again, I'm adding or subtracting because it's connected. The 5h, or the negative 5h, is attached to the 19 by subtraction. So we'll add 5h to both sides. Be careful with your integer rules. Also, be very careful with this because this may happen sometimes. That negative on the 19 is still there. That minus sign now makes it a negative 19. And then on the other side, we get 5, and then we have minus 8h. So now we have a two-step equation again. So we have the 5 needs to disappear. It's attached by subtraction. It's a positive 5, so I'm going to subtract 5 to make it go to 0. So we have 5 minus 5 is 0. Have to do that on the other side to stay balanced. So we get negative 24 equals, just like we did with the negative 19, we can't lose that negative. That's a negative 8h. And then we divide both sides by negative 8. We've got a negative divided by negative, which gives me a positive 3. One of the things to keep in mind from this problem as you're working through your own is being careful that you're not losing negative signs as you are working through the problem, because that will drastically change the solution to the problem, and then you'll end up getting it wrong. So let's look at one more. So here's one where we have distributing that needs to happen first. So remember that distributing is when you're taking the outside number and then you're multiplying it by each term inside of the parentheses, however many terms there are. In this case, there were two terms, so each of those are going to get multiplied by negative 5. So we have 13 minus 3n equals, then we have negative 5 times 3 is negative 15. Negative 5 times 2n gives me negative 10n. What you do from here is up to you. Since a lot of times we've been focusing on the end, how about this time we focus on the constants? Let's add 15 to both sides to get the constants together, because we know that's eventually going to have to happen. So we've get 28 minus 3n equals negative 10n. So again, making sure that you don't lose that negative sign. Now we still need to get the n's to be on the same side. So now in this step, we could add 3n to both sides. I don't want to add 10n because that would move the 10 over with the 28, and I want the n's or the variables to be away from the constants. Remember, a constant is a number that doesn't have the variable on it. And so negative 3n plus 3n, that goes to 0, leaving me with only 28 on the left side. And then on the right side, we end up with negative 7n. Then we'll divide both sides by negative 7, and we get n equals negative 4. With all of these, we could check them, and you should check them on your homework or on a test to make sure that you have the correct answer. And we check them by substituting in the variable back into the equation and seeing if the two sides are equal to each other. These two questions are for you to do, so go ahead and pause the video, solve both of these equations, and then resume the video to see the work and the answer. So here are the two answers. For the first one, I chose to subtract 23n from both sides in order to get the n's to all be on one side. And again, the opposite of a plus 23n is subtract 23n. You could have done something different. So what's more important here is if it looks like you are doing the opposite operations on both sides and showing your work, and that you get n equals 9. Now, once I did that, I just had a two-step equation, so I got rid of the constant by subtracting 74 from both sides, and then divided both sides by 2 to get the variable by itself, and to get n equals 9. For S2, I chose to move the x's over to the right side this time, and I did that by adding 11x to both sides. You can see here that those do cancel and go to 0, and I'm left with 32 equals 104 plus 6x. And then after that, it was just a two-step equation, so I subtracted 104 from both sides, and then divided both sides by 6 in order to get x equals negative 12. So what we're going to look at now are some word problems, and there's a new pattern to go along with this new type of equation when you have variables on both sides. So the patterns that we've already done were this one and this one, where you have the rate times the amount plus or minus a fixed value equals your total. And then the bottom one where you have two things being added together, but then they both have some version of the variable within them. If you're unfamiliar with those patterns or unfamiliar with solving equations with word problems, I encourage you to go and watch my video on lesson 2.0C, and we'll go over all of that sort of information in that lesson. Today's pattern looks a little bit different because since we have variables on both sides, what it looks like is it looks like the first equation that we had, except the way that it's going to be worded is that you want to know when two things are going to be the same. So you're going to have a total, and then you're going to have another total, and you want to know when they are going to be equal to each other. And so that's how you know that an equation is probably set up like this, is that you want to have two different things that are being calculated, and you want to know when they are going to be the same. So let's look at our first example. So let's pretend that Dallas needs to rent a moving truck. Suppose Company A charges a rate of $40 per day, and Company B charges a $60 fee plus $20 per day. For what number of days will the cost be the same? And that's a pretty valid question when you're moving. If you have different companies to work with to move your belongings, depending on how long you need the truck, will dictate which company you might want to go with. Because the one might be cheaper in the long run if you need the truck for, say, 5 or 6 days. But if you only need the truck for 1 or 2 days, then maybe another company is cheaper. So just like any other word problem, we need to define our variable and organize our information. So what is it that we're trying to find? We're trying to find the number of days. We don't know that. So x is going to be the number of days that we're going to rent this truck. Now we're also trying to figure out when they're the same price, but we'll get to that. What else do we know? Now, since we're talking about two different companies, it's going to be important that we organize our information in that way. So what do we know about Company A? Because that's going to be a part of our equation. And then what do we know about Company B? That's going to be another part of our equation. So Company A charges a rate, and they literally tell us rate, so I'm just going to write R, $40 per day. And that's it. That's all they got. They've got that rate value. There's no fixed amount for them. Company B charges you a $60 fee for some reason and then only charges you $20 per day. So on the surface, it looks like B is cheaper because it's only $20 per day, but you got to put out $60 no matter what to get started. So that $20 per day, that's a rate. That fee is fixed. That doesn't happen every day. It only happens once. So we want to know when the costs are the same. The total cost of company A is equal to the total cost of B, because that will help us to know which company we want to use. And we'll talk more about that at the end of the problem. So how would I calculate the total cost of X days for company A? Well, if company A does it for one day, that's $40. If they do it for 2 days, that's $80. If they do it for 3 days, that's 120. I'm multiplying or adding 40 each time. So we have a rate times an amount. Notice the per parts match, so I can multiply those together. So 40x would be the total amount of money that you spend for X days of service. So if it's for 5 days, that'd be $200, 40 times 5. Company B's formula will have a little addition in it since we have that fixed value. You're going to pay that $60, but then you also have to pay 20 times the number of days that you are using the vehicle. So here we have company A on the left, we have company B on the right, and I want to know when they are equal. So I have variables on both sides, so I'm going to need to solve this. So I'll subtract the 20x. The reason why I'm subtracting the 20x is because I need the variable to be away from the constant, but also to be with the other variables. So we end up getting 60 equals 20x. Then we'll divide both sides by 20, since the opposite of multiplication is division. And we get x equals 3, and that's 3 days. So I'm going to write the answer. So the cost of the two companies will be the same on the third day. So why does that matter? Well, because if you only need the truck for 3 days, then it doesn't really matter which company you go with. If you need the truck for 1 or 2 days, then the first company, company A, is going to be cheaper because it doesn't have that fixed value at the start. For day one, it costs you $40. For day two, it costs you $80. Where for company B, it costs you $80 and $100 because you have that initial fixed value that you have to pay. After day three, so days 4, 5, 6, etc., company B now becomes the better deal because you are paying a lower rate per day than company A. And this is when they are equal. So, but here on day three, you're paying $120. But after that, company A becomes more expensive because it's adding $40 each day, where company B is only adding $20. So there's where it would be important to understand that sort of piece of information. So we solve this equation just like we've done with all the others in this chapter. We've defined our variable, we've organized our information, and then we wrote sort of a really basic verbal equation. And then we wrote our main equation, we solved it, and then answered our question as a sentence. So here's another example. So we have Jonah and Lizzie are making smoothies that have the same number of fluid ounces. Jonah uses 3 containers of yogurt to make his smoothie. Lizzie uses 2.5 containers of yogurt to make her smoothie. How many ounces of yogurt are in each container? So, sort of a weird question, but let's just start breaking it apart. We've got a picture here with some information. We've got some information in the word problem. So let's start organizing our facts and see where we end up. So the question part of the sentence pretty bluntly tells you what it is we're trying to find. So we have X is the number of ounces of yogurt. So what do we know? So we have two people, so I'm going to organize them in that way. So what do we know about Jonah? Well, we know Jonah, if we look at the picture, uses 6 ounces of juice. And they tell us that he uses 4 containers of yogurt. And then Lizzie has 12 ounces of juice. And she uses 2.5 containers of yogurt. The last thing that they tell us is that how many fluid ounces they have altogether is the same. So we know that Jonah's total liquid is equal to Lizzie's total liquid. So where is that liquid coming from? Well, the liquid's coming from two places. It's coming from the juice, and it's coming from however many ounces of yogurt are getting put in there. Before we go any further, I do want to add a little bit to my variable. So if you look, the variable says how many ounces of yogurt. Well, that's not technically what the problem's asking for. It's how many ounces of yogurt are in one container. That would be a better way to define your variable. And that's actually my rate. So this is an example where we don't know the rate. We do have a fixed value. We have that there's a fixed amount of juice in each of theirs. And then that other number, the 4 and the 2.5 containers of yogurt, those are the amount of yogurt, the amount of containers that they are each using. Those aren't a fixed. It's not a rate. It's that number that gets multiplied by the rate. So this problem's a little bit different. We haven't looked at a lot of problems where we were trying to find the rate, but that does happen sometimes. So how would we calculate Lizzie's total amount of fluid ounces? Well, we have the fluid from the juice, and then we would need to add to it the fluid from the yogurt, however many fluid ounces of that there is. Well, how would we calculate that? Well, it would be the amount of containers that she uses times however many are in each container. So that's that 2.5x. That's the rate, which is x, times the amount of containers that we used. Jonah, on the other side, is similar. He has 6 ounces of juice. And then to that, we need to add in the yogurt liquid, and that's going to be 4x. Since we have 4 containers, multiplied by the rate per container. And the reason why I went back and redefined my variable a little bit is because I needed this container unit to match up with the container unit so that I can multiply 4 times x, have the containers cancel, and be left with 4 ounces, the unit that is left when you multiply x times the number of containers. So here now we have an equation that can be solved. So I'm going to subtract 2.5x from both sides. I don't need those parentheses around the x. I just put them there initially. And when I subtract that, I get 1.5x plus 6 equals 12. Then I subtract 6 from both sides. Then I get 1.5x equals 6. Then I divide both sides by 1.5. The opposite of multiplication is division. And I get x equals 4, and my unit is ounces per container. So I can answer my question. I'm going to answer it up here by the picture. So each container of yogurt contains 4 fluid ounces. Notice I went back and did one more thing also. I went back and modified my variable once again and added fluid ounces both on my answer and in my variable definition. And the main reason for that is that ounces and fluid ounces are not the same. This problem, unfortunately, uses in the picture ounces, but they're not talking about ounces of juice as in a weight. They're talking about fluid ounces. When we're working with different units of measurement, we do need to make sure we're using the right units. So in this situation, this problem was a little bit different because we were actually finding the rate, but the structure was still the same. We had two things that we wanted to be equal, and we set them equal to each other once we had their expressions, and we solved the equation to get the answer. So here's our next question. Teresa earns a weekly salary of $925 and earns a 5% commission on her total sales. We'll talk about commission here in a second. Roman earns a weekly salary of $1,250 and a 3% commission on sales. What is the amount of sales X that will result in them earning the same amount of money for the week? So let's talk about commission real quick. Commission is a business that sells things, and the person who sells things to you, they earn extra money on top of their normal salary when they get you to purchase things. That's what commission is. So a perfect example of that is like going to a phone store like Verizon. Those people, they'll want you to buy a phone, but then they'll want you to buy different accessories there because all that money that you spend, they get a little bit of that back into their paycheck as a little bonus. So let's organize what we know. We're trying to find the amount of sales, and that's going to be money. How much money that they each need to sell so that their amount earned for the week is the same. Now, as with all the other problems in this lesson so far, I am going to organize them based on people or by objects. Since we are talking about two different groups, we're going to organize the information in that way. So Teresa has a salary of $925 per week. Now I know that's per week and that's a rate, but in this situation, this is a fixed. It's a fixed because we're only looking at 1 week in the time. Our main thing that's varying is the commission amount of money and the sale money that they're making, which that is independent of your salary, your base salary. And then we know that the commission percent is 5%. And we'll talk about how we calculate commission here in a minute. Then we have Roman. And he has a fixed salary of $1,250. And a commission, 3%. So his commission is 2% less than Teresa, but he earns $325 more dollars each week than Teresa does. So the way we find commission is by taking the sales money that you get and you multiply it by the percent commission. Now, whenever you're working with percents, we convert them into fractions or decimals to actually do the math. So in this problem, we'll use 0.03 for 3% and 0.05 for 5%. If you don't remember, in order to change a percent into a decimal, you can either do the percent divided by 100, or you can take the decimal and you can move it two places to the left, and that's where I'm getting those values from. So we want to know when Teresa's total money is equal to Roman's total money. So how is their total paycheck calculated? Well, their paycheck is going to be made up of two parts. It's going to be made up of their base pay, which is what their regular salary is called, and the commission. And then Roman would be the same way, his base pay plus the commission. Well, the base pay numbers we know, so we can put those in pretty easy. So we have 925 for Teresa, and we have 1,250 for Roman. And then how do I calculate the commission? Well, the commission is the sales times that percent. And so the percent for Teresa is 0.05. And the sales, we don't know. That's what we're trying to find. So that's my X. And then for Roman, that's going to be 0.03 times x. So now we have an equation that we can solve. Just because there's decimals, we don't do anything different. We need to get the variables to be on the same side, the constants on the other side, and we need to isolate the variable. I'm going to subtract the 0.03x for both sides. The main purpose of that is just to keep the x being positive here, but you could do something else, and that's fine. So then we get 925 plus 0.02x equals the 1250. We'll subtract 925 from both sides to get 0.02x. When we subtract, we end up getting $325. Then the opposite of multiplication is division, so we'll divide both sides by 0.02, and we end up getting x equals $16,250. And remember, that is the amount of sales that they would need to sell. So give me a second to write the answer. So they would each need to have $16,250 in sales in order to earn the same amount of money in a week. So notice in all these problems, we've been following the same process. We've been defining our variable, organizing our information. That's what's happening on the left side of the screen here. And then writing a verbal equation and a regular equation to help us see what's going on, and then solving that equation to get the answer, and then answering the question with a sentence. This problem is for you to do, so go ahead and pause the video and try to set up the equation first, then resume the video to see if you have the correct equation, and then once you have the correct equation, pause the video again so that you can solve the equation for yourself and answer the question. So here's the equation that you should have. There are a couple of things about this that were a little bit different than some of the other problems we've done. The first thing to point out here is that Kelsey is withdrawing her money from the bank. And so that means that while she starts with a fixed value or starts with a starting amount of $550, she is losing money over time because she's withdrawing it and not depositing anything in. Chris, on the other hand, his was a little bit different, because he was depositing two different amounts of money. And so the amount that he's depositing each week is $35. And so that's why I have 35x being added to the initial $10 that he had in his account. If you wrote 15x plus 20x instead of the 35x, that's perfectly fine. You're eventually going to have to combine the like terms eventually. But here's what your equation should look like. So go ahead and pause the video and finish solving this question. So when we solved the equation, we had variables on both sides. So I chose to add the 25x to both sides to get the x's together to give me 60x, and then subtracting the 10 from both sides to isolate the x a little bit more. Dividing both sides by 60, since the opposite of multiplication is division, and then I got x equals 9. And so they will have the same amount of money on the 9th week in their accounts. And then after that, they'll have different amounts again. So in this lesson, we learned how to solve equations where there are variables on both sides of the equal sign. And we do that by using opposite operations in order to get the variables to be on the same side. And then after that, we just solve the equations as normal. This completes the lesson. You are now ready to begin the homework.